standard.
Doso yala conga badrava rigbe doje shavlanga chantara abundance of a lamar boche dage chevora bende den yon. Cutting chamber gone ages on the cosum took yang orders are to so.
Lari.
ta rang don thar jin chue chi go ta nga na so che dang ge do wa ri to ge sim je tam je la lu nga yi sum sing ge di yo wa re ta ma da pe cha ne rang ye ge lu nga yi sum ne do yo re la ta pe cha ne yin na ta nga na so ge rang sem te ta che mi chue chi go se ne ngo ne ta ne ge sem rang ge ngo te la ta ko ra yong tam je da tal yong ne kon na den yong be kap so la ta ngo tam ba chue chi go se ne ta chu go la do ge yo de te yin do ka so la te ta bo ge chu go ge ne lu te ngo de chu ba yin na te ne rang ye ge ten ta chim ba te ta chue chi go yin ba ta rang ye ge kon ta chim ba de chue chi go te yang te ne te ke rangin la teni rangi ge ta ten thar chin ga sunga ta bo mai pa ta te la pa lom thi u pe ka su la ta pe na tu ke che pa de pa ba ta la ten ne teni yin sem ye tom je ge ton to ta ta to ngon de chu ba chu ko ngon de chu ba te la ten ne yin sem ye ge ton do la teni zu ko zon zo ko yume che sta ta pe ke ta do ja tham je ke tham do la te ni ta ye no zo ko yume che se yon de ta te la zo ko sing ge te la ngo ne tha ne ke zo ko ni se ne do yo de te yen do ka so la ta le ta wa tham je ke do ve ke tham do la long jo zo pe ke ko tham Then the Lamada Batamki, Dorvik Chadola, Tropa Cote, Tay Nina, Zogosig Yodi Tate, I will choose you got taking honey. Again, Doja Tomki, Tooks and Dumbam, Tooki Chapa, the Pabig, Doja Jonger Chebigat on the La, then the Longjo Dope Cotton, then Zogo in the Jumachepa La Pegyodis. Tet our pepper and the big thing yet our lama chol and do send us on.
Continuing from where we left off, the next song is found on page 110. It begins with three lines of homage to the guru. Dharmakaya, your own benefits achieved. Rupakaya, your benefit of others is unceasing. I bow to my kind Supreme Guru. Here, Terchen Barway Dorje praises his Guru as the embodiment of the two or three kayas or bodies. And the trikaya, the three bodies, are what constitute the primary aspects of the being of a Buddha, and in that sense are equivalent to the body, speech, and mind that each of us has as a sentient being in samsara. Now, when someone reveals fully to themselves the nature of their mind, that empty nature that is self-recognizing becomes, or is properly called, the Dharmakaya. And since that is awakening, that is the ultimate achievement of that person, now a Buddha's own benefit. So therefore, referring to this, he says, Dharmakaya, your own benefits achieved. But the Dharmakaya is more than simply the perfect benefit of the person who achieves it, because it is also the basis of the constant or unceasing display of form bodies, or rupakaya. So therefore it says, rupakaya, your benefit of others is unceasing. Through the rupakaya, that Buddha benefits others. In more detail, the rupakaya is said to have two aspects, the sambhogakaya, or body of complete enjoyment, which is how the rupakaya of a Buddha is perceived by those with pure karma, and the nirmanakaya, or emanation body, which is how it is perceived by those with impure karma. Both of these are displayed unceasingly for the benefit of, in order to guide or lead others. And keeping those attributes in mind, he says, I bow to my kind Supreme Guru.
Soma rampap semni ni zimi nyom ngandu kyon ne tam mne redo pan yimi tesam tondo so kyona chunghe ngo tang yakwe rando lo dan tar tukun lamar mugu tang kyolam talten dondo so kanki madip payo sam yon do chong we tang chin do sum le ta te la ta ni gi ko te ta ran hyo ke sa bo da bo hyo hyo sa sum te yin da ha jang gi ye gi go ya ma do ta rang sem so ma se na ta ke ji tang bu ke sem ge ta ko ran ka re da ji ta thain wa yin na ya ta te so ma ta bo se ne sum ga de te ta bu ge ma rang so ma rāmbāb kī sīmīyī tē, tā tāngbō sāṁ sātāb kī sīmīyī tē lā, tēnī tē kī ngō lā, chū chē kī ntūndzī kī lō kī, kōrā pā kā yō nā māngbō zō mā sōng wā tāb kī kī tō nī, zimbā mē pā sīm tē kī kī ngāng lā, tā yō mī ngāng tō kiong tō pā yī nā, kiong ar chā wā tāng, tē tāb sīm tē kī ngāng lā, yō mī ngāng tō kiong tō kāp sī yāng, Tene ne tamne redo pang sta o tang ending wala nyomung on the chung token dog. Yapun dog negin dog samba chick some no tansan and your sourdings. The summer marrying is called ne tak penna getting nipa penna takona nom talk your sourdings. Yet up ne begin to he tongue. O tan ding wala ne took him milk some begin to he chunga in a young. Take your savare, te tabo mebeg goni, nomdo kijig matambo kari, shava yina yang, shama tado tege, kingana ya. Nipikab the yamba to shava yina yang, shava tege, gola rangi, get again on a yani, then it tell a korangom yapo, doxambeke rewata, negim mendoxambeke. Togwata, negin doxambe rewa la soba kaya, mepateta veredo, yonzu doba sam jipang ni, yimi tesam re marisambe tesam number na soba tang, tangone, kisem nello yanta bati, king tondo chena, sambe tondo double so, kare chua yina yang, chua kare chua ti chunken korang motig. Namto kare xa yungna tando, tando yabbeke namto ndamochi xa yungna ti namto korangke rango lata ni, teke jesu mando wache ni, chungya, chungna, chungkenki ngo teke ngana, ta yungwe kapsu lati ni, oneta namto ke ngo te rangyenge, tongpare te yore te indo, te ngo la tong sungari. Yakpe rando lo tatas, yape tati tabungole yap to bayina tini nomdo te kora ranging, geta kora sozo to tondo yod mato chigitella nomto yemba kipa do triyanda was a tortuganda was in the magova chene rando gelo than tando yodi stuk laman mugu lama lancer of lama laughing in that.
Lasso.
Tukun lamar mugutang, tata tu jundo la, sozuku zava lamala. Tepatang, muguzoyatang. Jolam taden dodo so, ta docha nyandog jolam kare yinaya, tarwiki kav yinaya rong, terwiki kav yinaya rong, ndrobu kav yinaya rong, depi kav yinaya rong, te dodo so kangi madrip. Payo tam se te tabutak chawakari chegi yonayang. Te tamche ke dip masungwa. Madip sena penna ta te tabuki chik. Ta chik sem ne tam te la. cha thama te koro nom to yemba che ge thu ne na thame kha ya me pa nom to the rang ngo la kona hyo yona mena da bu ne pa te nom to te ge ngo la yo ne kona cha thama kona ta ta kha se do ko pa yu sam ge du he de cha thama dep som ata bu mai pa ta nom to te ta bu kha de kyo a yin na ya Kange pa yu samgen duhete kora kora de masonwa teni kora te tu jondola ne tobandabo tu jondola yun jong tobandabo tende samki yu jut hirak karki mori pa yu sam jondo jongwe to jindo setate tabo teni kora yun la manchu ne jong tobayina tatonki mori gore.
The next section of the song presents instructions similar to those that we went through this morning. It says, cultivate this fresh, natural mind itself naturally without fixation. Abandon hope and fear of stillness and movement. If the doubt, is this it or not, and the desire to see arise, rest in the nature of that for which they arise. They will be self-liberated beyond the intellect. Continually cultivate devotion for your guru and attention unobscured by variations in behavior, such as slow and fast or walking and sitting. Great benefit will be accomplished. Because this is so similar in what it refers to or what it describes to what we went through this morning, in a sense, there's no need for me to provide a detailed explanation. However, at the same time, because some of the terminology used is new, I will explain that. For example, in this song, Terchen Barway Dorje uses the word fresh to describe the quality of awareness. Fresh here refers to the quality of direct awareness of the present moment of experience. It's called fresh because it is not a continuation of the past, which would be stale. It is not conceptual. It is direct experiential awareness. So the instruction here, again, as in this morning, is to cultivate a fresh, natural awareness and to do so free of fixation. Now, free of fixation includes what he then specifies, which means a hope of one state and fear of another. Here he talks about the hope for stillness, a hope for the mind to remain still or inactive, and the fear of motion or movement, fear that thoughts will arise. And the reason why there is no need to hope for the one or fear the other is that if you can simply sustain or rest in a freshness, the presence or absence of thought does not constitute an issue. However, if you start to think about the meditation, that becomes a distraction. So therefore, he says, if the doubt, is this it or not, and the desire to see arise. Doubt, which entails in its nature speculation about your meditative state, is a distraction. And when that distraction arises, or the similar a distraction of the thought, I want to see more clearly, I want to recognize more clearly, and so on. When those arise, then he says, rest in the nature of that which recognizes them. In other words, when any thought arises, no matter what that thought is, if it constitutes a distraction, then rest in the nature of what recognizes the arising or presence of the thought. Therefore, he says, rest in the nature of that for which they arise. They will be self-liberated beyond the intellect means that when you rest in the nature of the awareness that recognizes the thought, which is in fact the awareness from which the thoughts arose, the thoughts do not need to be separately or additionally dealt with or responded to. They don't require what would be called other liberation or the liberation by something other than themselves. And this happens without any kind of conceptual imposition because the awareness in which you are resting is that same freshness or fresh awareness with which you began. Since it is an immediate or direct awareness of the present moment, it is not a conceptual awareness and therefore is beyond the intellect. He continues, continually cultivate devotion for your guru and attention, these two faculties, devotion and attention, unobscured by variations in behavior. This means cultivate these two things, devotion and attention, no matter how active you are, which is why he says variations such as slow and fast or walking and sitting. Sometimes we can cultivate a mindful awareness amidst some activities and not amidst others. Here, Terchen Barway Dorje is saying, learn to cultivate them independent of whatever the activity or circumstances may be. Unobscured here means that usually our attention is so affected by our degree of activity that it becomes obscured or diminished when we are especially active. And the advice here is not to allow that to happen. And if we can gain that level of mindfulness accompanied by devotion, he says, great benefit will be accomplished.
That dungar sum garangiri te yindu kapsula ta tela pembe ge ta chawan da bo ten ni yang ta pe gi chu du ya te ri jon sen cha la ten ne ten ne ta kho an de la yun ne bo ne na ga ya che da yo ma ri a sam ba ta bu ge ran ki ge ta so zu ge sem la pa cha zang bo ya se na ya ro sem la on ne ta ne ge lo do nam ji nyam ne ge to ne rim be gyan do kho wa la lo do topic tabla ton sena yaron tenen khowa tela ton de he ding ni he chan da bo me ba kadu pa na ya ta pa chho chho da bo re topic ge tenen kho pa ding ni ma shen de ton do ta he chan da bo ti pa na kam te gi ya bo re tam sik min de ta bo song sta tam sik chho ge tam sik la ma da che do ge tam sik la so ba ton do ta kora ni sota changsim sangha la so bu ge tamse kare yo yo ba yin na ya ti na ni ta ming de ta bu ti song on du kap so la ta kora ta ti sota ge dom ba so on de ba de ba sa endo
tamse so na sangha ge dom ba yin sa re te je la dom ba se ge do wa
ming de ta bu song song do wa ming de ta so ta bu song se ge de che ba ka yo Ganela so tau song, Ganela Minga tau song singing with the thick quiet and the Chapakan order.
The Chapa Yosama.
All us. Minga tau song, Sladam Chuji Yetinla. I yam the chin yigar pong, started tau get.
I have one
slap a get dumb bakan yam, but the tom jetty. Then it chew yam tapa, dub to big yetin. Yam ten la bore di yori, te yendu kapsula te tabola yamna, teni ten dalaya pongata, chimalaya pong yimichana, the chin yigat pong, sona, nekab tatu guns, te tabu sonaina, ta nekab la dewata gewata, tatu rim gendo lana me becoma, tabarcheva chena, tatu kondo dehing. Gave minyam song, dehing gave a younger, set up a latine, tate minyam pason you the carchin bodies. Lama ransom damila, nearing donda mepa yin, ta sozigitab la matetan, can it rang sem te dava mepa days, lama ransom dami senayarum, ta one get tepata mugu latine. Ranke sing nelu yang tabate to yum capsula lama sene chirola jig tak onetane ge shata ge pumbo jig sordo yaba tab mainpa lame ge to tang then rang sem yeme parande and they say on the capsula rang sing nelu on the chur yum capsula then it Java samji yishie loona chiksin nga naso sungu yori, tenda wola cha yanandiki yori, te mena ta pena dehing himbo ndoku yona chapsin nga sungu yori, tenda wika dehing himbo te, teni ngone taneke yang takbeke nelo la, ta ngonda wote tongba ri. Tongba teke simje tamje la chap deba te, teni ngone lame toke yonten tang, rangsim tongbeke yonten te, Tamata tariumbe capsule, yemeba, reumbe chena, tarang semla, lamate, dava mepala, yuk debata, che mepanda, mepala, yuk debata, but in the radiori. Tatella, teni lamate, oh, nilamate, tarimbojela, yu, yu, sambatan. Oh, nilamate, nyasajela, yu, johnsa, me, some sanda, but in the can do she kaya, mepe ketoni, nyering, get some notan. Lama de Tanda Yoga Maringat and Yanal Pepsawari Sambatan Tanda Yogi Yori Sambatabugan Duat and Dava Tetabugan Duhi Nyerintan Dundagan Duhi Mepegatoni Tukun Yarab Joba Lob Statu Kundula Yarab Gijoba Zambu Gijoba Tendela Slavia de Shedag Karchen Bodhi Yena Hingi Pensem Do Yen sim jetam jela, yin jeta dembegoni, talunga yi song shabdo kari, doptum naya, tetam jela, pembek sim, tetam jete, deva topic, chawandavo,
The next section of the song constitutes somewhat more generic advice. And it begins, half your life has already been used up by samsaric work and deeds. Another way we can understand this, Rinpoche said, is that in any case, half our life is always used up by samsaric work and deeds, because no matter what lifestyle we pursue, we have to spend at least half our time ensuring that we have the means of survival, place to live, food to eat, and so on. So this makes us so busy that of necessity, half of however much time we have is going to be used up by samsaric work and deeds, in other words, things that are purely for the benefit or purposes of this life. So the question arises, if we have to do these things, how do we view them? And Terchen Barway Dorje says, it would be best if you let go of craving internally. And this means that while we may have no choice as to what we have to do in order to sustain ourselves, we can take either of two attitudes toward it. When providing for the needs and comforts of this life, or for comfort in this life, becomes an object of continuous fascination for us, an object of endless craving, then in the context of doing necessary things to sustain ourselves, we are also unnecessarily accumulating a negative habit of craving. Craving for things that, while they're necessary, never in and of themselves bring true satisfaction. The alternative to this is to, as he says in the song, let go of craving internally. That doesn't mean that we need to externally change what we do, but we can change our attitude by recognizing that while we have to sustain ourselves, that what we do in doing so is of no lasting or ultimate value, and therefore not a fit object of craving, because it can never bring the happiness that our craving makes it seem to us it might. In that way, in the same context of having to provide for our own needs, instead of causing that context to be also the accumulation of negative habit, it becomes an opportunity for the accumulation of the positive habit, of the desire for freedom, and the recognition that things are impermanent and not worth investing into. So in short, while we may not choose what we have to stay alive, we can choose to either crave or let go of craving. Next, he says, guard samaya like your eyes. Samaya here refers principally to your samaya with your guru or gurus and with your dharma siblings. By extension, one could say that it refers to all of the vows you've undertaken, including pratimoksha, the bodhisattva vow, and so on. But the idea is to principally protect these things the way you would protect your own eyes, your own vision. He continues, vows are the basis of Dharma. If they're broken, this life and the next are ruined. If they're kept, you'll be happy and good now and in the end, so keep them. In the same way, having taken any vows or samaya, if you keep them, they will form a basis for happiness and well-being in this and future lives, and if you break them, they will bring about the opposite. And then in the toward the end of the song, he writes, your guru and your mind are inseparable, beyond distance or parting. When someone recognizes the nature of their mind, they recognize the single nature of all minds. This is therefore also the mind of the guru. As is said, all Buddhas are one in the expanse of wisdom, and all beings are pervaded by Buddha nature. Similarly, when someone recognizes the nature of their mind, they recognize that there is never any distance between them and their guru, because the nature of the guru's mind, which is the true or ultimate guru, and the nature of one's own mind are the same. This recognition frees one from such thoughts of separation or proximity as, oh, the guru is too far away, when will I be closer to the guru? Or, okay, now the guru is nearby, I feel comforted by that. Or, well, right now the guru is far away, but soon the guru will be close by, and so on. The whole concept of distance and separation vanishes with this recognition. And then finally, he writes, always behave nobly, always be compassionate and benevolent toward others. Always behave nobly means always behave kindly and helpfully to others, and do so because you are motivated by compassion and benevolence toward all others. And then he concludes, since my disciple Kunzang, presumably an abbreviation Rinpoche said of Kunzho Samten, said, I require instruction and advice. This was written by Barway Dorje. So we thought we would stop now and take questions, because there will be no afternoon session tomorrow afternoon because of the empowerment. So we should have some time for questions now.
Yes?
Could you explain a little bit more about Dharmakaya and Rupakaya?
I didn't follow all of it. Sorry.
Chuku zuku ni ke ko shita goma sonse.
Chik sa cha ya bo ya nang ya nang risan do.
Te ya bo ma re. Te ne ne lo jo ndo no ma na lo sung ge do. Te che ge la ka te chi sha la te na te ge ma.
Ya ya ta te ni te ni. Ta te na chogo ta. Chogo ta zuku ni se do ta. Chūjī kō sēngiān tē, ā rāndōng tō chūgō bēn ā rāndōng tājīn chūjī kō sēnā sōng rō wā. Tā rāndōng nā chūgō ngōng tō chūjī kō sēngiān tē, tā ngā rāndō tāngwā nā gōng yō rī. Tā mē nā tā mē wā nā bō rī tī yō rī. Bēn nā tā dēshī ngīng bō rō gōng yō nā chāp. Rō wā tāng bī sāngjē rā kīng tē sēnā sōng yō rī. Dēshī ngīng bō. Tā chōku tōngyē tēke sēmjē tāmjē lā chāp yōpārē tē yīndu kāpsu lā sēmjē tāmjē tē tā tātō kōrā sāng yāpāṁ
Well, to start with, the Dharmakaya is defined as the ultimate achievement as the ultimate achievement of one's own good. And so in that sense, or that context, we could say that the Dharmakaya is the ultimate achievement of everything we all really want. And the reason why it is possible for us to achieve, if we use the term Dharmakaya to mean the result, where the Dharmakaya is revealed, for us to achieve the Dharmakaya is because it is and always has been our true nature. And that is what is meant when it said, because all beings are pervaded by Sugata Garbha or Buddha nature, all beings are of the Buddha type. saying we're of the Buddha type means that we are naturally disposed and naturally capable of becoming Buddhas. And this is because all beings possess minds with the same nature, often referred to, simply Rinpoche said, as emptiness. And that is what makes the pursuit of the path meaningful and the achievement of the result possible. If the Dharmakaya were not our basic nature, our true nature from the beginning, then it would be impossible to achieve it. And any achievement that were actually created by the path would necessarily be composite and temporary. Now, the Dharmakaya being our true nature, Buddha nature, the Dharmakaya is present within a sentient being, is perfect, but it, at the same time, it is concealed by our individual ignorance, which you could think of, Rinpoche said, as the misapprehension of the mind's emptiness as a self. And that misapprehension leads to all of our thoughts centered around I, me, and mine. Now, all of the methods which constitute the Buddhist path are designed to directly or indirectly lead to the exposure or revelation of the Dharmakaya. In other words, lead to our seeing what we have never seen. And especially this is true or expressly true in the case of the Mahayana and within it the Vajrayana. But in particular, there is a quality to the path in which the on the path, the dual aspect of Buddhahood, the a perfect good for oneself, the Dharmakaya itself, and the perfect good for others, the Rupakaya or form body, is represented, or its equivalent is present. For example, in the case of bodhicitta, when we generate bodhicitta, a relative bodhicitta, this has a dual focus. It has an aspect of wisdom and an aspect of compassion. The wisdom aspect of bodhicitta is its focus on perfect awakening, the wisdom that recognizes that only perfect Buddhahood is a final answer. And the compassion of aspect of bodhicitta is its focus on all sentient beings, which is the compassion that recognizes that one can only achieve Buddhahood for the benefit of others. One cannot achieve Buddhahood for one's own sake. Because that dual focus is the motivation with which the path is begun and conducted, then when one achieves the Dharmakaya as a result, there is the natural display of the wisdom and attributes of that Dharmakaya as whatever other beings are capable of perceiving. And therefore, for the benefit of those with such purified or rarefied perception that they can experience it, the Dharmakaya will be experienced by others as the Sambhogakaya. And for the benefit of those without such purified perception, it will be experienced as Nirmanakaya, or emanation body. That was your question, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Rinpoche, this question comes from somebody watching a webcast.
While our birth here may not have been intentional, if we continually make aspirations in this life to be close to Rinpoche, the Karmapa, and other holy Dharma teachers in our future lives, and aspire to do our best to practice their Dharma and help others, even if we don't have any realization or the ability to choose our next life, will making those aspirations help us, mm-hmm. at least somewhat, guide our future lives? My two biggest worries are that I'll not be reborn where I can meet my guru, and that I'll not come in contact with those or lose the aspiration to achieve Buddhahood for the benefit of all beings. I want to do whatever I can in this life to prevent that.
Mm-hmm.
Malam singete pe mas pe shu chen bo re san je jam ne de ke la kwa ya che ki cha ja ja me to kan che no kan ne cho ne ten san je ko ma to bar cho so na ta to la ta nge ba ji se ne e shu chen bo so re so yo re de na ta so te ten ne sam na ra le ge de ta ko kyawa kondo yanda lama tandame chwe jipala se ne koba samu sani mepe ke gondon don dena ta koran donbari mato chege tumde yanda pa chege yongri se gondon tizkara kapo yori te yendo kapsula ta ngone ke te tabu ke samu tamu ke kapsula yena yang tene ngone ke kona donba tato la sem gendu hete yang the child, your big one, some not done, then it don't take yapo, some tobayina, then it corn chugging, drevas and get the yards have a capsula, then a chanchum, him book a part of sending man, checho to that, ground to yag yori, then they get jumps in Latin, that thing you put that word, jigre, mato, jigata, tell a machemata was in there, you see, matis, then the jigrees. That dig simjin de ngage chapson dobe ke khazari dig simjin de ngala dat anke khazari ta tele chama ni jita ni gom gaya gi jute mundo ponge na otle mari konata yundo la poche ke mata to se gore te ta nyemnya khase lem lem da bote tende ngaran su ke sonde ta monam ra le gi ori tamse sunya sonde monam javala ra le gi ore ta te tamje ge tonje de sama ina tene meje bu kang ge zan yo mare ek de
The power of aspirations is inconceivably great, and that includes the power of the aspiration to, in every lifetime, encounter one's gurus and receive Dharma from them and continue to pursue the path. With regard to the power of aspirations, the Buddha said that if someone conceiving of perfect awakening were to raise even a one hand in a gesture of prayer or devotion, not even both hands, and raise one hand to their heart, doesn't mean like, you know, that in itself would cause them to be irreversible from the future achievement of perfect Buddhahood. On the other hand, the making of aspirations has to be heartfelt. It can't simply be the mindless repetition of verses of aspiration that we've memorized. For example, at the end of many lineage supplications, we recite the stanza, in every birth may I not be separated from the glorious guru and so enjoy the splendor of Dharma, having pursued or completed the paths and stages, may I speedily attain the state of Vajradhara. And we recite this at the end of several lineage supplications, and because it's so important, but at the same time, because we recite it, either from memory or reading it in the text, we're apt not to be thinking about what we're saying when we do it. And the mere parroting of a liturgy without mindfulness, without mindful attention to the meaning, does not constitute an act of heartfelt aspiration. But if you really mean it, if you really with all your heart pray for those things to come about, they will. The primary factors in ensuring access to your gurus and therefore to Dharma and so forth in successive future lives are the intensity of your aspiration for such access or to such access, and the purity of your samaya with the guru. Although even minor violations or fluctuations in your samaya and relationship, while they may cause some sporadic difficulty in gaining access to the guru in future lives, will not cause a permanent separation, because all Buddhas love all beings, each as though they were their only child, and that cannot be stopped. Nevertheless, the degree of ease with which you will encounter your gurus in every future life and the degree of proximity to them that you will experience are largely functions of the intensity of your aspiration for such ease of access and proximity and the purity of your samaya with them. If those things are provided, then your access to the guru in future lives is a certainty.
Dear Rinpoche, I am experiencing great sorrow for the suffering of a beloved one on my inability to help at this time. What is the best way to work with this emotion in the context of today's teachings? Does that make sense?
Well, I don't quite know about the context of today's teachings, but the question itself makes sense. The Tuatri can take it, the Nidra Chigam, Ropo Chigam, Choga, Chemen Kayina, Dungal Trapo, and Yongi Oris, Dene Morangam. They're suffering because they can't help the other person suffering? Debbie, what was it again? They're suffering. Trying to translate it, I completely forgot what it was.
Let me go back to it. I am experiencing great sorrow suffering. For the suffering of a loved one and my inability to help.
Yeah. de pa de ensare dona de de moronga de choka de de la de dunga trapo yores de moronga de con la ropo de de shera zotumdes coronga dunga sel togamares de la tene moronga sempa pe me chogidos
ta de la ona pone de mi banda vosana de la
Remedies in such situations include, first of all, practicing taking and sending, tonglen, apply to the person that you feel unable to adequately help, and praying to Guru Rinpoche for their benefit, using the common Guru Rinpoche mantra, the name mantra. And also, if you know it, the seven-line supplication, the seven-line prayer. And at the end of the session of reciting the mantra and or prayer, that you dedicate the virtue of it to all beings with that person whom you wish to help first and foremost among them.
Should I go ahead, or you want to? I have two more.
Yeah, go ahead.
Rinpoche, could you please explain the relationship between the Dharmakaya and what I have heard described as the clear light? Are these two things identical, or if not, are they related? And if so, how?
Chuku sewa de dong, usayo sewa de ni chikpare kakare.
Well, the clear light or luminosity is a term that is used in several ways and therefore to refer to several different but related things. So when it refers to the clear light or luminosity of the Dharmakaya, then it is the same as the Dharmakaya. And when it's not, when it's used in other ways, then it's not. It was correct, but not very helpful. We should work for Microsoft.
And then one more from somebody watching the webcast. My question, in the first line on page 108, your mind is stainless, instantaneous awareness. Is stainless a synonym for empty, and is instantaneous awareness related to spontaneous presence?
Oh. De ta ta te seni jime rikpa kechik ma seve kapsu yena jima mepa de dang tongba ni chikpa rebe dang rikpa kechik ma de dang lunrup chikpa rebe. Donas de rikpa de la seni ni sondo wa namba chik de na jima mepa. Amba chik de na ke chik ma data wa ke rikpa re. Denye de dona denye ke kadak tan lunrup la jalwa yo re pes. Sheda yo mi hong de la. De tso wa kadak rangi ke sha re do. No, not particularly. I mean, you could equate stainlessness with emptiness, but it means that it's really more than that. It's without, it's flawless. And the instantaneous or present quality of awareness is not particularly connected with spontaneous presence.
Okay.
Thank you, Rinpoche.
Is that it?
For now. Could you pass this
over? Rinpoche, I have a question that is under the line. If you want your guru's blessing to enter your heart, so it's the line underneath. And you did answer a little bit when there was a question about aspiration. But I'm still, because I'm contemplating about devotion last couple decades or more, because I understand this is a key for the realization of the mind. So I'm interested in words. And then you mentioned the prayer as a, you know, just a, which was really great for me to hear. The prayer as a like a key part for the devotion. So the two words that I'm interested is in continuously and then fears, right? So it's continuously meaning can I like just do it while I'm washing the dishes, you know, that type of
Are you blood. Fierce when you're washing the dishes? Sorry.
No, I don't like doing that, I have to say. So maybe that's how I can get into washing the dishes, liking it. Or is it like a formal prayer that it's different than what we're reciting?
Oh, yeah. The morangatua dires, the lamji ne the tissue, the mugure. Sanghaman ne gosong de sanla mopo tongwa yin. De nan de soba dapa ge tsula, de jundu soba dapa tang, de nu mugu drakbu gane soba dapa ni song yores. De tang su jundu soba dapa sena pena leka lesho de soba dapa digere pe kanda song yonam. Yana mixel to tunzung ne sowa dapa konala segi yonam. Then in yusana mugu drakpo sana drakpo kanla segi yore de la.
Ta dinana mugu drakpo yun to sowa tap sung.
Lazo
diganang to wine.
Let it, did it.
Tatya nange kora sowa tabia tela. Shu chejon. Kaseji, that mata, nubachijon kandeji, yom yon davote. So, so sugge, sab lama, then devachijon davote la legate. Tatella, do she sinking the pemasi baki, kalchambori. That so sugge, lama tella, lamegan to she that. That I think for that lamegan to she davote, you know. Sonda monum bizuva yena yam. That's on the phone of Edison, that's on the phone of Lam Dushi Yor Edison, Lam Dushi Yori. The Yena Yan Takura Dushi Chunyo gave a thing, that's on the Zua Yena. Tell her some big kitchen of Chinchuka days. And then the Matoyan son, no, 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 Marie. That's on the Shun drink water with the Jenny. Got a Lama Tea on the Tanaki. Tell Shepard Pap and Dushi Yana Mandawa, then you send the Dushi and that was the Yarni. Sonda Monum tell a show chess and that was Taba Yena. Lama sitting in a taking the bottle than a penny beyond my day. Neduka of the lot tells a thumb to get up, get and then you will use. That dig and Nana move Tabu, John the saw a top song in day.
It's just the image.
Lama teya, one tisum gatanje tom jege, cook more than you were done. Then it's so so yen, I tell a tisum, some of you go, then it check that lot of linkers,
It's not a funny question, and none of what he said is funny, so I don't know why we're laughing, but we are. Well, in the order of the Tibetan, the fierce devotion comes before they pray continuously. So Rinpoche addressed the term fierce first. Fierce devotion addresses the fact that prayer can have varying degrees of force or power depending upon the degree of connection between the person praying and, in this case, the guru to whom they are praying. But the degree of connection here refers to the scope of the person's perception of the guru. If you see the guru as a lama, and you pray to them as your lama, and you are praying to them, it qualifies as prayer, and you have some appreciation for them, so that qualifies as some degree of devotion. But it's very limited, because your perception of the guru, just as your lama, is kind of limited. So therefore, the amount of benefit that you will receive, the amount of the effect it will have on you, is going to be limited as well. If you see your guru as far superior to others, as someone amazing, and then even though you're supplicating to the same guru but with a different attitude, the effect it will have on you will be far superior. And if you see your guru as the embodiment in one of all Buddhas of the three times, and you have an attitude of unreserved entrustment, that is, that you entrust yourself to them without any reservation, without any conditions, without holding back, that is what constitutes fierce devotion. And the word fierce here, the word of in Tibetan, of course, can also mean violent or aggressive, but it doesn't mean that you behave violently while praying, or that you grit your teeth and bite your lower lip and quiver with rage and so on. It means intense. And in the intensity is derived from these two factors, the one being the vast scope of your perception of the guru's qualities, that you see them as all Buddhas of the three times, and the other being the unreservedness, the lack of reservation in your entrustment. So that's about a fierce. Now, when it says continuously, it means not sporadically or capriciously. Often, our supplication of the guru, our prayer to the guru, is capricious. Rinpoche said, when we feel good, when we're having a good time, then we feel like praying to the guru, because we're in a good mood, so why not pray to the guru? And when we're miserable, we don't want to pray to the guru. So I don't want to think about that stuff now. I'm too miserable. And that's the opposite of continuously. So without caprice or capriciousness. In English, can you just say caprice? Or you have to say capriciousness? Caprice. You can say caprice? Okay. And in this country, you do say caprice? I know that. That's why I'm being careful. All right. So, all right. You don't say caprice or something? I just don't know. All right. Yeah. Now, John, you had your hand up for a long time. And
I just liked the question, or was thinking of the question that someone else asked about the instantaneous essence of awareness and emptiness on the one hand and spontaneous presence on the other. And when you were replying with Rinpoche's answer, Yeshe, you used the word in reference to mind, what was it? Uninterrupted or... In reference to the emptiness nature of mind, the rupa kechigma. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to remember the adjective that you used.
Dhrimamepa.
Oh, stainless. That's right, stainless. Is stainless, or if kechigma is the same as stainless, then wouldn't unobstructedness also be the same as stainless?
I don't think he said that kechigma is, well, we'll ask him if kechigma is the same as dhrimamepa, but there are two attributes to the same rigpa.
Yes.
De rikpa ke tseni magakpa ke dedang chikpa rebe, kandare do. Kichik ma dang, drima mepa dang, dona de semji nilo ke rikpa de la, tseni genane, drima mepa dang, de kichik ma nyi son doa. Gapa mepa deyang rebe dang, gapa mepa ke tseni yana, gapa mepa ke tseni seba de dang,
It seems that they'd be pretty much the same because they're always put together in the same lists of beyond filling, beyond emptying, and so on. So it would be the same quality of being unlimited. There might be some slight differences in terminology.
Thank you.
In the cultivation of freshness for the nature of mind, which I find inspiring because it sounds simple and accessible, mm-hmm. is that... Would that be like a union of shamatha and vipassana, remaining in that, and how does that exactly work? Is it by habituation to that state that it kind of wears down the kleshas and helps one realize the nature of mind, or how does that how does remaining in freshness help one?
That is yapa somag ngala netsana, the somag ngala nepa de shilak zungjuk rebe. Shilak zungju yena degi gone soso ke de drepa de che sapta drava ke de jutsen karere.
Ta tela
We've got a ping pong game going on over here. No, you won't answer it? Truly resting in freshness, the as Terchen Barway Dorje describes it, Rinpoche says, would be resting unwaveringly in the present direct experience every moment of the mind's nature, which would be the ultimate state of unified tranquility and insight. He's joking because that one time, many, many years ago, a gentleman came for an interview with Rinpoche, one of his peers, and announced that he had passed through most of the bhumis, but he was having trouble achieving the 13th bhumi, the final state of Vajradhara, and wanted instructions on how to just make that final bit of... California neon can go. Yeah. Wow. Okay. I got the story wrong. The gentleman concerned said that he had achieved the 13th bhumi, the state of Vajradhara, and therefore required instruction on what to do next. Wow. Then there must have been two of them, because there was one guy who had only achieved the 10th bhumi and wanted to know how to get the... They don't... he'd achieved it. Oh.
Yeah. Rinpoche, I'd like to ask a little bit more about working with our minds, our wild minds in particular, and kleshas. My wild mind, actually. I appreciate the advice this morning and the technique of how to recognize your mind by looking at the affliction. And in terms of the reasoning, I mean, say you have this affliction, which, you know, I'm recognizing more that I have this certain klesha, all of a sudden came out of nowhere, basically, it felt like. And, you know, it's been a little disheartening. I can't seem to get a grip on it. Or I'm trying, because I'm intentionally trying to, praying that I can be more patient. So... I'm just wondering if you could help me in terms of the reasoning. How would I work with impatience? And is it then when you say to look at the reasoning behind it, are you reasoning that, you know, I recognize I have it, I know I need to work with it, I'm trying, I'm praying. And I guess is the reasoning more like analytical? Am I trying to analyze my own responses, or is it more just... what's the approach
around it, I guess? Song. Dene de pomato na dene de sanye dan chanchu sampa dan lama namba tsama la sova tap de pongto pa ge renshe dan denpa ge go de le de sova tap na pengire son son. Tata de morong niecha ne nyomong karong shuk che tsam lobo de longwares de la la kea mendoze. The la kebe ge le do the sanlo tonso kanra go do.
Ah, tunda te yo. Yo la pe yabo no ba. Mone tan sen ne ro ta ya.
La so.
Kono la ke a me ba che la na. Kono te ge mo lo ba ta ya.
La so.
Te la te ni ye la mando ba che.
La so.
Mo kono na ta ya na. Ba che te ni yabo pendo chenbo yuwa da.
Well, first of all, consider this an opportunity rather than a crisis, because an intense klesha clarifies your mind. So that when the klesha is present, instead of allowing the klesha to direct your attention to the supposed object or stimulus, look directly at the nature. Look directly at the nature of the klesha itself. Because when he said don't follow it, which means that when we're under the power of a klesha, we actually look everywhere except at the klesha. So he said, look directly at the klesha, and you'll be able to see the nature of your mind, because it will be so illuminated by the force or intensity of the klesha. For example, if you find yourself intensely angry, instead of fixating on whomever it is your mind thinks you're angry at, look directly at the anger itself, at the stuff, the substance, if any, of the anger. And the anger the intensity of the anger will so illuminate your mind that it will be very easy for you to see its nature. That's what he said. So the advantage of what you're talking about, an acute klesha, is this. So don't forget that kleshas are really just thoughts. They're a current or a trend or a theme that is reoccurring in our thoughts. But what makes intensely kleshic thoughts different is that most thoughts are like sneak thieves who you become aware that there is a thief in the house of mind. But by the time you try to track it down, it's already taken the valuables and gone. It's already fled. Most thoughts they're subtle, they're slippery, they're kind of fast. They're like sneak thieves. And therefore, they're very hard to pin down. And therefore, they're very hard to use as an opportunity of clarification of the mind's brilliance. So on the other hand, intensely kleshic thoughts are so outrageous, so disturbing, that they're more like muggers. They're not like sneak thieves. They're not subtle. They're not hiding from you. They are highly confrontational. They're muggers. And as such, they give you an opportunity. Says that's my outlook on it anyway.
Rinpoche, one more question from the from the webcast. Dear Rinpoche, thank you very much for teaching. Can you please explain some key points we can reflect on when trying to maintain pure samaya with our gurus and Dharma brothers and sisters?
Tata de lama namba dang to checham la damsik sungwe ke le to kare sam go to
checham la tande sam ke le
lama namba dang doje checham la dane de damsik sungwa la kare go to ta
te kona sungja tande ke na sa bo sungja jo
The sematropa senate samshin the sematropa.
So basically, as is clearly expressed in most treatises on samaya, the key point to keeping a good samaya with your gurus and dharma siblings is not to pick fights with them, not to attempt to make them mad, not to intentionally do stuff to like torment them or make them mad. And and to be in harmony with them, to be nice to them. Except for her. Yeah, yeah. She's the opposite. You need to treat her with it, you know.
Okay.
Yeah. Says that another technique we could employ is that what's used in some Japanese corporations, where a boxing bag is kept in a back room, and every time one worker gets angry at others, they take a timeout, they go into the room with the boxing bag, and they pound the bag until they're exhausted and no longer angry. And then come back to work.
It's my favorite.
We'd need about 30.
Thank you, Rinpoche. Actually, it's funny you mentioned the bag, because this is part of my question. You're talking about when, and I've tried to do this, look at my mind when I'm in the midst of a very intense klesha, and my intense kleshas more often than not are anger, mm-hmm. really intense anger. Mm-hmm. And it's been a recommendation I've heard before, and I try to look at it, and what I am finding is it's hard for me to separate the mind from the physical body. Mm-hmm. And I find that if I try to just sit and look at it, I'm literally getting sick. Which is probably good, because I don't want to stay angry. It's poisoning me. Uh-huh. I experience the clarity only if I can divert the anger from doing something nasty to doing something neutral or positive, like clean the house or cook a meal. And then I feel that clarity like I just had coffee. Uh-huh. But I'm not really getting, oh, that's my mind. You know, it's hard for me to separate how the body is reacting physically to it. Otherwise, I should have been a Buddha by now with all the anger that I experience in my life. And if there's any recommendation, what am I not doing? What can I tweak in this, in looking at that?
I want to make sure that I understand. I mean, I understand the words of your questions quite clear, but I want to make sure I understand what you're talking about. Right. When we get angry, we often feel a lot of physical sensations. In my case, for example, mm-hmm. my knees get weak. Mm-hmm. I feel a weakness in the knees. I feel sick to the stomach. Mm-hmm. So are you talking about the fact that when those things have already occurred, and you try to look at the anger, the inseparability of the physical sensations and the emotional state of anger causes looking at the anger to become an intensification of the physical discomfort, or does it cause you to become preoccupied by the existing physical discomfort?
Maybe it's the preoccupation.
Okay.
The clarity I only get if I'm actually doing something, but
no,
it's
I think
clarity.
I got it.
Yeah.
That was what I needed to. Okay. Da diri da. Da soso ge da morang ge nyomong ge na ne dukshu control esi. Da soso ge control langwa yana maung chawa la de lupo la tsawa. Machi po da mongpo lewe doa, de trego lopa dong, de ne de lakpa daya la sopa, de mongpo yorwa. De yongere. De yende, he's amused by my physical sensations when I get angry. So are others. De yende, moronga de control ke ngowo, shedong ke ngowo la, ta yondo, de control rang ke ngowo de mata, Sonang dopo de la de ta shogados. Then it's sonang dopo de zotogmentos. Dig in yempo kandago.
Ta hajange. Pem massi bagge nyomon bangaja. Sho shembu go on to show away, you know. Digging on the lamps up, this valley.
Lasso.
This valley. And that your uncle says it then the. Nadia can more tell a dia yanni. That shake yam yon taking gold at the pipe jokes had it. That take a summer reggae of Maris.
All right,
take the Pendle Hajang Chamber Maris. The teller take Taji the Aka Tadi Yoma Bangajak want shores on those. The takes the Yabochum and those some big tone against him. The council was that. Yes, Yang Tabuke. Some look down on Yena, Kora, Hing, men and Hing Yabadabu, Dog Yoday, Barchet Dog Yoday. Ta Aka, Tade, Numbanga Jago on Shondo. That takes a chome and looks and make a tick such a sosuke. Jabata, take a toll and a tajik, tick such a conjo somna. Take the same Shabapu and Dawach and the Yandamanda, which is in the Java Yena. Kale kale latine kondo sa yona yang tene lug number ton to gyur mando wala tene sembu ngote la ta tong ken tene de regre te kora nyomo yondo gin la dan tere te yindu kaso te hajang hale ya shi dan
Rinpoche, it's not, your experience is not that surprising. It's not, in other words, it's not an abnormal experience. What it sounds like, he said, is that the intensity of your, the episodes of anger of which you're speaking, the intensity is so great that it's simply overwhelming. And that your awareness, which it is not easily stabilized, wanders off or bounces off from where you try to direct it, which is the nature of the anger, and focuses instead on the overwhelmingly intense physical sensations. And that's not surprising, that's not a big deal, but it means that you may need to begin the practice of using the opportunity of anger to look at the nature of mind with slightly lesser states of anger, so less intense episodes. And in the case of the most intense episodes, which are too overwhelming physically right now for you to work with in that way, he said, use the faculties of reason and regret. Whenever we rejoice in something we've done, a mental state that we found ourselves in, or something we have said or done physically, we reinforce it tremendously. It's like putting wood on a fire, which is why we want to rejoice in good things. But the problem we have is that we tend to back up our kleshas with a set of rationalizations that constitute rejoicing. Why it was good that we got angry, why that was appropriate, and we really told them, and all those things. So the first step is to make sure that you're not doing that. Mm-hmm. Don't rejoice in the anger. And try to do the opposite, which doesn't mean guilt, but it does mean regret. So when you... while you're angry, first don't act on it, and then think, okay, I have become extremely angry. This isn't good, because every time I've become angry in the past, it has led to undesirable consequences. It would be unreasonable for me to assume that doing the same thing again is going to lead to different consequences. So therefore, do I really want to be this way? And that won't get rid of the anger entirely, and it won't get rid of it all right away. But it will start to, if you do that enough, repeatedly enough, it will start to tip the balance to where you'll still get angry, but for shorter periods of time. In other words, the period between getting angry and regretting being angry will get shorter and shorter and shorter. Mm-hmm. And eventually you get to the point where as soon as you start to become angry, you start to already regret it. And at that point, your anger will be manageable, and you can use it as an object of meditation.
Now, hopefully I don't act out as much as I think I don't, you know, which has been the benefit of meditation and the Dharma. I get the waves of anger, and more often than not, sit with it. Mm-hmm. And stew. Mm-hmm. And then try to direct it towards something positive. You know, mm-hmm. Certainly don't act out. You know, people don't see what I'm feeling on mm-hmm. the inside. They may get a little bit of it, but they don't mm-hmm. see all that's turning. And it sounds like a stupid question, but should I feel remorse for feeling? I mean, is there any dharmic good to feeling remorse? Oh, I'm angry.
Regret.
Just to feel angry? I mean, I certainly feel regret if I act out and I hurt somebody, but should I feel remorse for just feeling it?
Yes. Yeah, you need to. Because anger is never the basis of anything good. So it's appropriate to regret. There may be a little bit of difference, though, between the meaning of the word regret and remorse, okay. But it's so individual, and it may be a matter of connotation. Okay. Regret is the way you'd feel if you had drunk poison. Mm-hmm. You would really wish you hadn't drunk it. Mm-hmm. It's not whether you're a bad person or a good person, but you're a person who drank poison. If you don't do something about it, you're going to get sick or die. That's okay. Regret.
Okay.
And that's what you want. You know, I guess you could say remorse.
And I'm so sorry, because I thought it was going to be quick, but now I'm realizing I really need clarification on this. So if anger is an opportunity, because it can be boom in your face, like you say, like a mugger, should I feel, I'm trying to understand why I should feel remorse for something that could be a pathway for greater understanding and awakening. Is it, and I was under the impression that on the Vajrayana path, everything is workable. Everything can potentially lead to greater awakening and use for the benefit of others. So I guess I want to be clear on this.
The number chik de na, shedong shuk chimpo jona, de semgo shepa ke gokap zambo re sons. Yang number chik de na, shedong.
Ngati, docha hedan temo ngaja tado thinking yomomba ngati
It isn't a direct contradiction, because there are differences in context. One of the differences is intensity. When as a klesha is so intense that as soon as it arises, it's overwhelming. And being overwhelmed, we fall under its power. Then there is simply no possibility of using it as a basis for recognition of the mind's nature, because you've already fallen under its power. And even if you have the external discipline or code of behavior so that you don't act out on it, that may not prevent you from being internally overwhelmed by the klesha, in which case attempting to use it as an opportunity for recognition would be fruitless. And in that situation, it's more appropriate to apply the antidote to the klesha, so that if you have a fire that looks like it's going out of control, rather than attempting to channel it and use it in a certain way, the best thing to do is just pour water on it and put the damn fire out. So this is true of any of the five kleshas, or any of their infinite branches. But it also varies among individuals, because we all have all five kleshas, but people are of different makeups. And some people have much more of one or another klesha than another. Some people are naturally more disposed to anger or pride or jealousy or lust or apathy than the other four. And Rinpoche said, I've seen this. I have seen people who are so angry that they bite through their lower lip. They bite all the way through, and their teeth meet, and they spill blood, and they faint. Says that's an angry person. You know, that person has an anger issue. So when someone's anger is that overpowering, that overwhelming, they don't have the time that it takes to look at, and so on. In that situation, the best thing to do is to give the person means to slowly make the anger manageable. And eventually, when you get to the point where a klesha arises, And not only do you not act out on it, but it doesn't overwhelm you. Then you have the space and the time it takes to actually be able to look directly at it. So the issue is whether or not the intensity of the klesha permits the exercise of the faculty for recognition. If it does permit that, then there's no need to regret it. It can be used as an opportunity. But if it's so intense that it does not permit that, then regret rather than further reinforcement is going to be a better solution. Here we go. Oma Sabozo, then on the Gonga look. De Tonga, do that she drug it.
Oh, my God.
I just don't see how that would work, but anyway. I've never heard of that. I don't quite know what to do about that.
This story.
The thing to remember, there is a serious part to this at the beginning, and then it just gets out of hand. The thing to remember is that the intensity of our kleshas, no matter how great it may be in the case of a particular klesha for a particular person at a particular time, is simply the intensity of the mind itself. The power, you know, the power invested, so to speak, in the kleshas is the power of the mind, from the mind, in the mind, invested in that klesha. So it is very much the case that we create our own kleshas. We empower our own kleshas. And we can, therefore, in a sense, we have the power, including through a belief, to pacify our kleshas. And then Rinpoche told a story. He said, this is my favorite story about the rising and pacification of a klesha. And it concerns the klesha of lust, sexual desire. I mean, you knew that just by the amount of giggling, right? And at one time, once upon a time, a European man decided to become a Buddhist monk. He was a Buddhist monk, right? Not a Catholic?
No, okay. No, no.
Yeah. And, but he was an incredibly lustful person. And therefore, he would experience states of unquenchable lust that would fill his mind until he was in tears and in a state of all-round
shivering.
Yeah, shivering, shaking, yeah. And lacking any other remedy, not knowing how to help him, his companions, either they must have come up with the idea. Did they tell him this would help, and that's why he believed it? They just did it.
I guess so.
Yeah. They started to. Heat up milk, and mix eggs in it, egg yolks, and he would drink this hot milk with eggs, and that would pacify his lust. So whenever he would experience, why would it? It just doesn't make sense, you know. I don't know why that's funny. It's just improbable.
Yeah.
Anyway, oh, you mean like saltpeter?
Oh, he knows.
Well, saltpeter would. Maybe they were giving him saltpeter. That's a whole other story. If they were spiking it with saltpeter, that's made to do that. Does that? No.
Going at the egg, then
it was just eggs and milk. Yeah, said they were desperate. They needed to calm this fellow down, and so they made him hot milk and eggs, and. Every time thereafter that he, it worked one time, and then every time thereafter he experienced an episode of acute lust, he would ask for hot milk and eggs.
Yeah, I think it's really up to the mind, you know. He thought that helped, you know. Thought that helped, there's no connection, you know. What to do with the milk and egg. But, you know,
that's
he thought
I can think of.
That
it's
helped.
For him.
Other people are really desperate. They don't know what to do with it. They can't bring somebody because he's a monk. So they thought they come up with. So it's really a matter of mind, you know.
Well, that's a Zol sense.
So on that auspicious and colorful note, we'll conclude.
Oh. What did him?
I think that seemed to be the point, especially.